Now, I don't have time, but Mr. Jones, I'm kind of glad that he wasn't allowed to go to Asia, because if he had gone to Asia, he would have celebrated with the, y'all forgive me, but with the Japanese and the Chinese and the Vietnamese. But since God didn't let him go where the Chinese, the Vietnamese, and the Japanese were, he got a chance to write a letter in Rome that landed in New York, got all the way to Texas, and I got a chance to read. I'm trying to tell you, God been in my corner a long time. God was in my corner before I got in that corner. Y'all gonna pray with me? The vision stopped him and departed from going to Mysia, from Bithynia, and he came down to Troas. There they comforted many and planted churches by using love. Yeah. Tell your neighbor, they used love to plant churches. Yeah. The book of Jeremiah, the 31st chapter and the 3rd verse said that the Lord appeared in olden times unto them, and he said, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Yes. And therefore with loving kindness have I drawn. We would have a much larger church if we employed more loving kindness. Hello? You gotta quit hunching them sisters next to you, cause the lady who came in got a short dress. That might have been the only dress she got. And if you don't like the one she got on, buy another one she may wear. That Bible told me, and I wanna put it in practice today, it's a man looking on the outside. But God, what does he look at? You can't see a man's heart. The x-ray just tell you whether it's beating or not. But only God knows what's in a man's heart. Paul got somebody here to have a drawing you, he said. Those results can be found in the book of Acts, 17 chapter verses 1 through 4. But it says that some believing Jews and some converted Gentiles formed this assembly. So the letter, 1 Thessalonians, is Paul's first letter. But it's placed 8 because it is a letter that does not need to address one sin. Corinth is a farther written letter, but it's first because it had so much sin. And if I got somebody in here who's honest about it, the reason God is always dealing with you is because you got so much sin. Yeah, y'all don't like me tonight. Summarization of the chapter is found in the 3rd in verses 6 through 7, where it says that Timothy returned. Paul had dispatched Timothy to go to Thessalonica. And he had come back with the news that these people were growing and their maturity, Christian maturity, was expanding. Yes, isn't that good news when you know your children know how to wash the dishes and you ain't got to rewash them? Isn't it wonderful when they can make up the bed and ain't no cat faces in it? Isn't it nice when they can iron their own shirts and you ain't got to send it to the laundry before they can wear it to school? That's what was going on in the Thessalonian church. They were doing things so much better, it made Pastor Paul proud. Yes, the context of sacrifices is the watchfulness, because the people had rocked themselves to sleep in a false peace. You may not believe me, but that's where we are in America today. This is a false peace. We shooting down planes in other countries without getting approval to do it. And nobody's saying anything. We watching it on the news and going to sleep at night, not being worried. But you need to know the people at whose planes you're shooting down, they got a bomb that they can deliver all the way to America. Somebody said the other day, they ain't got no plane to bring it over here. There's so many of them they can hand carry and get it here. We need to be careful about how we're treating other people. You don't watch it, the devil will lure you and rock you to sleep with a false peace. Yes, Lord, help me today so this lost world will be trapped. People will start to think that they're safe and secure. But here in the text, the Apostle Paul begins to reflect on God's love. How nice that is. He got to reflecting on God's love. He knew that God could have killed him on the road to Damascus. He knew that God could have paralyzed him when he fell off his horse. Y'all remember Superman? Y'all remember he got paralyzed? Yeah. Steve Reeves, whatever name, falling off his horse. But Paul fell off his horse and didn't get paralyzed. I'm trying to tell you how good God can be to you. If you quit looking at other folk and look at what he's doing with you, you will stop talking about other folk and just begin to celebrate the God that's being so kind to you. Come on, tell your neighbor, he's been kind to you. Been kind to you. Well, I'm going to move now, but only if God's people obey him and his authority. Because if you do that, you can accept the fact that he has made you his choice. Some of the time we have difficulty believing that God loves us as much as we do. He does. Because we know us. We know we mean rotten and low down. And some of us dead all at the same time. Y'all don't want to talk back to me. We can be unkind unnecessarily. Oh yeah, we can be snooty. And if we don't watch ourselves, we hypocrites. You know how we smile as soon as you turn your back? I say, if you can't say amen, say ouch. So here, Jeremiah 3:15 says, I'll give you pastors according to my heart who will feed you with wisdom and knowledge. What you need may not be what the person next to you need. God is the one who differentiates and defines what each person will need. So here we are. One of the first things I found in this text is comforting advice. Tell your neighbor, comforting advice. All advice ain't comforting. Amen. Sometimes you go to the doctor tell you quit eating what you've been eating. That ain't comforting advice. Hello? And so here in verse 11 it says that he's encouraged. He says encourage one another. We used to do that. I remember when I was growing up, the folk across the street could use my daddy's car. They could come over and get whatever they need, coffee, sugar, and nobody kept score. They even borrowed my mama's run stocking. Sometimes my mama borrowed theirs. Their children could stay with us and sleep in the bed while we were on the floor when their parents had to go out of town. You know, that's the kind of thing that we used to have. We done got too big for ourselves. We used to have 5 or 6 families in one house. Now take 2 people in a big old 5-room house. We are not the people that we used to be. One of the worst things God can do for us is keep making a way out of no way. Comforting advice. I'm going to get through with a little sermon. He says you ought to unify. The Bible says walk together, children, and don't get weary. It also says how can two walk together except they touch and agree. Not only should we unify, we ought to edify. We ought to build up ourselves through loving another. Well, talk back to me. So the body is only as strong as its weakest link. Too many times you have a church and everybody in there sniping at each other, running each other down. And then we want to know why nobody want to join. And then we say now that the Corinthian church was large in numbers, but it was weak in unity. The murder, the Cain and Abel had started with disunity and it grew up to be disharmony. And then the church will not have God's servant nor honor him with love. There's too many times that we want him to do what we want him to do. But God put him to tell us what to do so we would do what he told us to do. And then I hear people say, well, the Lord talked to me. Baby, you better check them beans you ate. You didn't ate too late. Yeah, the Lord talking to you and you ain't the pastor. Yeah, it's got to be because you ain't late. God is going to talk to the head now. Can you see my foot telling my head what to do? Come on, talk back to me. Can you see my hand slapping my head? It's my head that tell my hand what to do. And this is the same thing that go on in church. Too many of us keep believing no matter what station you are in life, that you have a right to tell who the boss what to do. Now, if you really believe that, why don't you tell the boss where you work like you're trying to tell the boss where you go to church? If you can't say amen. I'm doing the best I can. I'll tell you something else I found in this comforting advice. We're going to have to glorify God. You heard I said unify, then I heard edify. Now I say glorify. Amen. You got to glorify God. See, when I'm dealing with somebody who's not quite right, all I'm doing is giving God a little more time. Because if he made them, he know all about them. I'm not always interested in me trying to modify them. I just want to be a comforter so that God will have something to work with. Hello, somebody. I don't need to criticize them. If I got a mirror, I got enough to criticize with myself. I can hear real well because I got big ears. Amen. I know, see, I can criticize me. I don't have time to work on you. Lastly, as this comforting advice, Christ's words were, if I be lifted up, I'll draw. Too many times we're trying to send folk to heaven and ain't going, I say. I'm talking about honoring a servant with love. Y'all know I'm right. Have y'all seen people? Some of y'all, y'all know there's some people in church, they've been trying to get you saved, and you more saved than they are. Every time they come around, they're trying to smell where you've been. Amen. Tell them to smell yourself. You've been there before. Come on, tell the Lord thank you. You know he was with you. He was right there when you were messing up. But now you done got saved and sanctified. Amen. Sophisticated. Before you know it, you're trying to straighten out somebody else's life. Brothers and sisters, the second thing I find in here is a cognizant acceptability. Cognizant means you see something and you understand what you see. Too many times what God wants us to do is accept what he's already done. Ain't got nobody here. And you got to know how difficult it is not to receive you. They wouldn't receive Jesus. And if people who are imperfect couldn't receive perfection, what you think it is that they should receive you? You got to give recognition to those, it says, who labor right among you. That's one of the problems, Lady Allen, in our church. Sometimes people deal with us, labor with us, and almost ruin their health trying to help us. And then we get ready to send an offering and we put it in the mail and send it to somebody on television. Y'all don't want to talk to me. And when you get sick, they ain't coming. When you need somebody to help you get your son out of prison, they ain't coming. When you need somebody to come to the hospital to pray you out of that city, they ain't coming. When your marriage is falling, they ain't coming. When you're about to lose your house and need to borrow some money, they ain't coming. Amen. The person right there with you is the one that you ought to be serving with. The one you ought to be loving. The one you ought to be lifting up. The one you ought to be helping. That's what God is trying to say to us. Right among you. Y'all can help me preach this. Case is that Paul had been driven from them. You go back and look in Acts, Thessalonians drove Paul away. But his love for them was so interesting and heightened until he left somebody there to work with him. Now y'all know if y'all kick me out, I don't want y'all to get along. I'm talking about me. But Paul loved them so much until he still wanted them to get along with him. He sent Timothy back. Hey son, go back and see about them. I'm still in love with them. I don't know about y'all, but you ever really found out who loved you? It's somebody you done talked to so bad they should have left you alone. But every time you look around, they're trying to help you. You stop on a dirt road and your tires on flat and up drunk that same Negro. Yeah, you done told him you didn't want him no more, but he done come right on back to change your tire. And when he get through changing your tire, he just throw the old flat tire in the trunk, close the trunk and say, have a nice night. Now he got you confused because he didn't ask you for nothing. Come on. And when you get home and call your girlfriend and start telling her about him, you know what you call it? Crazy. But the next time you have a flat, guess who you're looking for? I ought to have somebody here trying to help me go along. Pastors. Why do I say pastors? Have to be defined not by their suits. Have to be defined not by their shoes. Or what car they show. They got to be defined by their labor. That's what God is saying in the text. He said, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know your labor. That's why I call him a servant. He got to be employed. He got to be working. I hear about pastors who do not visit the sick. I'm aware that some churches have a pastor that won't preach a funeral. I've heard about pastors who will not counsel or baptize, nor pray for the members. But James 5 and 14 told me that if there's any sick among you, you ought to be able to send for the elders of the church. And I want to know tonight now who is the same among you that will anoint you with oil and pray the prayer of healing, and you shall recover. And my brothers and sisters, if you don't know who labors among you, then you ought to not be shocked that he don't know who's sick among him. 1 Timothy 5 and 17 said, let the elders who rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in doctrine. Come on, somebody. The writer introduces a theory that overshadows a relationship between a pastor and his parishioners. But he says here now, yeah, know them. That means intimately. That's what the word know says. When you look in the book of Genesis, it said Adam knew Eve. Yeah. That's getting to know her personally. That's spending enough time with her that you could smell her breath. And that's what he says. If you really want to work with a pastor, you ought to know him so well that you're aware what he likes to eat and where he likes to go. That said, know them that labor among you. And then he said that you ought to have those that labor, that means reach for you. And then he said those who are over you, that means they reign and rule. Then he said that they are in the Lord, that's righteousness. And then he said that admonish you, that help regulate you. Are you listening to me? That means that God is saying you ought to recognize those who reach for you, and those who rule over you, those who reign you, those who are righteous for you, and those who regulate you. Not as a civil magistrate who use law and books and rulings and court cases, those who are elected to judge you, but you ought to know the minister who loves you, who has a heart for you, whose sincerity is interested in you, who is appointed and chosen by God to help you. Love is a business, and Christ knows his sheep, and his sheep know their shepherd. His voice, strangers know his voice. His smell, strangers know his scent, for he anointed their head with oil. His action is not hiding, but he's there for their behalf. And if you're going to do it tonight, you ought to do it in love. You ought to acknowledge him in love. You ought to stick with him in love. You ought to raise him in love. You ought to bless him in love. You ought to go with him in love. You ought to celebrate him in love. You ought to encourage him in love. Tell your neighbor, love is the key. Love is the strength. Love hides a multitude of faults. Tell your neighbor, the best thing you can do is fall in love with Jesus and let him love on your pastor. Baby, baby. Oh, I'm feeling pretty good tonight. The third thing I see here is creative accountability. Do you hear me? Because verse 13 says that you ought to esteem him high. Am I right about it? Let me tell you what God can do. God can give you a problem and you can't get it solved. But after you go to your pastor, he can tell you how to solve that problem. Ask me how I know. That was a Pharaoh that had a dream, didn't know how to solve it. But he sent to prison, got a man, and a shade, and a shine, a shower, and a suit. Brought that man out of the prison, and he told that king, you're going to have 7 years of salvation. satisfaction abundance. And then 7 years of a famine. Save the first seven, and you won't starve the second seven. Tell your neighbor, God got a man who can solve your problem. Well, now listen, as members, each of you are accountable to him.
Yes, sir. Yes.
But each of you are accountable for him. When he struggles, you gonna struggle. But when he ain't got no struggle, you ain't gonna struggle. That's how God done fixed it. I know y'all don't like it, but it's the truth. I found it in the Bible. It's the truth. Abraham, on his way back from a campaign in the war, ran into a preacher that he didn't even know. And said, now before you leave, I'm gonna give you 10% of what I got. And Abraham was never broke again. I ought to have somebody. Watch what God does. He says to Abraham, now you're having trouble with your nephew. You know what God said? You shouldn't have brought him. But you brought him because that's what you wanted to do. Now you're having trouble with him. But go on and give him first chance. And they said that a Lot looked up and saw the plains were well watered. He decided, I will get all of the water and then I'll be able to live. The Bible said that what he left Abraham with, God started doubling up the yield. And all of the grass started growing tall. And Abraham's cows started getting bigger. And then the other thing I found about Lot, that rascal didn't know that it was oil under them sand dunes. I wish I had somebody here. Yeah, all of them Syrians and other people moved where the water was, but Israel is still where the oil was. You need to hear me tell you today, you ought to love your servant, and you ought to do it with, come on somebody, all believers, and I'm headed to the house now. You got to stick with him. You got to have regard for him. You got to lay with God to rule and regiment and make righteous. Because believers must greatly value the ministry and the minister. Even when your pastor decides against your faith, when it seems he's gone against you, you still got to honor and love those that serve your heavenly interests. For it is not easy to tell folk when they're wrong, but it is our business to promote the welfare of soul. I guess I can't get no help up in here. But every now and then, you have to tell your children what